Hello everyone and welcome back to another video. And this is going to be a really, really basic one, since recently I've seen a lot of people, both in YouTube comment sections of my own videos and other videos, on Reddit, on Discord, I've seen a whole bunch of people who seem to be interested in hardware modding, extreme overclocking, but they seem to struggle with the basics. Like, they see a modded GPU and are like, this is awesome, but I have no idea what's going on. So this video is meant to kind of help people with that. So I'm going to go over the basic makeup of a graphics card PCB. This also kind of applies to motherboards, since they are very similar, but I do not have a motherboard right here, and I mainly do graphics cards, so specifics only apply to graphics cards here, though you can, in general, assume a motherboard will be similar. So let's get right into it. I've packed a couple graphics cards here, because they do come in various different sizes, shapes, and configurations. So I wanted to give you a good overview of what you can find on your graphics card when you take it apart. So the most basic, I would say, is this one here. Well, actually the 670 is more basic, but this is a reference PCB. So there are a lot of cards like this out in the wild, though I don't think 580s are still in daily systems, but nonetheless. So right here we have a GTX 580 reference PCB. This is another 580, but a custom one. Then I have a 670 over here, a 970 here, and then an HD 7770 over here. You can't really see them all completely on camera. I'm going to pick them up and show them to you specifically when the time is right. But I'm going to use this for my main example. So when you take apart a graphics card, you will always find certain things. So let's go over these very, very basic ones. The first two you probably know. So this right here is the GPU, the graphics processing unit. This is the main chip that does all the calculations on your graphics card. This is where the cores are. This is where, like, the shaders are, the stream processors if you're AMD. This is your main computational unit on the graphics card. Similar to a CPU on a motherboard, because a graphics card basically is a mini PC in itself. So you can think of this as the CPU of the graphics card, or just like the GPU in general, which is the graphics processing unit. Then around the GPU, you will find these black chips. These are the VRAM. These are basically the analog of RAM just for a graphics card, because just like a CPU in your PC, your GPU also needs to access files very fast and frequently, and those are stored in the VRAM. So now let's get into the more interesting stuff that not that many people know. That would be the VRAMs. So on NVIDIA cards, we have two main VRAMs. On AMD, we actually have three. I'm going to show that on this card later. So the biggest VRAM is the vCore VRAM over here. Then we have a smaller VRAM, that is the vMem VRAM. So as the name implies, the vCore VRAM powers the core. The vMem VRAM powers the memory and also the memory controller in the core, as far as I know. So, but you might ask yourself, okay, that's good and all, but what is a VRAM? So a VRAM is a voltage regulating module. And what it does is it takes a 12 volts power that comes from these connectors, or the PCI Express slot, all of these can provide 12 volts power, and it turns them into a voltage that we can use, because 12 volts would kill pretty much instantly everything, like the GPU or the VRAM. GPUs, let's just say for the sake of simplicity, run at 1 volt. That can vary depending on what card you have. GDDR5 like this usually runs on 1.6 volts, GDDR6 1.35, I don't know about the X variants. But yeah, that's around the voltages that the VRAM needs. So how do we turn 12 volts into the voltage that we need? Well, with the buck converter, and that's basically what the VRAM is made up of. So this vCore VRAM is a six phase, so we have six buck converters in parallel. Now what a buck converter is, I'm going to make a very basic overview. It's not going to go into the details. If you want details, I really, really suggest you look up actually Hardcore Overclocking. I have his channel permalinked in the description just because he's such a great source of information. Look up his video about how VRMs worked. He is going into the details, but here comes a very basic rundown of it. So a buck converter has two different kinds of MOSFETs and an inductor. So the MOSFETs are these black squares that you can see here. Usually they come in these packages. They can come in other packages, more on that later. And what these are used as are basically switches. So they can close themselves, they can open themselves. And when they're closed, power goes through them. When they're open, well, it's just like an open switch. There's nothing going through it. So we have two kinds of MOSFETs. Actually, you see that the second kind always has two working together, like here. So but the first kind is a high side MOSFET. The high side MOSFET is connected to your 12 volts power source and the inductor. And what it does is it closes itself, and when it closes itself, 12 volts goes through the MOSFET into the inductor. And when it opens itself, there's no longer going 12 volts into the inductor. And what is happening is the inductor basically smooths out the voltage that goes into it. So if you have the high side MOSFET go open, closed, 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 open, closed, 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 open, closed, 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 open. So like open would be 12 volts and closed, never mind. I'm switching this around. Closed is 12 volts and open is 0 volts. Sorry, I swapped that around. So occasionally the MOSFET will close and shoot 12 volts into the inductor, and then it will usually for a longer time stay open, and there will not be any power going into the inductor. What the inductor does, it charges up and it decharges. And when it charges up, the output voltage slowly rises, and when it decharges, it slowly sinks again. So if you shoot 12 volts into one side of the inductor, you do not get 12 volts on the other side. You start at 0 volts, and then it slowly, relatively slowly, it's actually pretty fast, but relatively slowly, it starts to rise. And if you keep the MOSFET closed for long enough, eventually it's going to reach 12 volts. But we don't do that. We open the MOSFET again when we are around 1 volt. Then we open the MOSFET, so the voltage starts to sink again. And when it sinks too much, we close the MOSFET again, so it goes up again. So basically, on one side you have spikes of 12 volts and 0 volts, and on the other side you get a more or less smooth, let's say, 1 volt for the GPU. And that's basically what the buck converter does. Now the low side MOSFETs, they have another role. I'm only going to go into the low side MOSFETs handle a lot more current than the high side MOSFETs, which is why usually you see two of them, so they are more efficient and can handle more current. If you really want to know what they do, watch the video I suggested. So, and yeah, that's what the VRM does. Like it gives spikes of 12 volts into the inductor, and the inductor basically smooths out the voltage and gives us a relatively steady voltage supply for whatever we want to power. Now, that relatively steady is not a perfect steady voltage. And to smooth it out further, we have capacitors. So those metal cans you see here, these are capacitors. Then the small multilayer ceramic ones, these are also capacitors. The black bigger ones that everyone was talking about on the RTX 3080 and 3090, these are also capacitors. These are different kinds of capacitors. And these are used for output, and sometimes you can see capacitors here as well for input filtering. But the most important ones are the output filtering capacitors. And what they do is, also, they charge up and they decharge, which is what a capacitor does. And basically their effect is they smooth out the output voltage even more. Also, I'm not going to go into the details here, not that much. I'm planning to redoing the video about cap modding and volt modding, so there will be more details on that. But yeah, I want to keep this video short. So let's just say the capacitors smooth out the voltage even more. And that means a more steady voltage supply for whatever you try to power basically means you get more overclocking headroom, because the minimums, so when the voltage does a zigzag thing, the minimum points, the low points where it is at, is actually the voltage that limits your overclocking. Because if you overshoot, well, it doesn't really care as long as it's not too high. But if you undershoot, like if the car is doing some heavy things in that moment, it's gonna crash if the voltage sinks too low. So you want capacitors to smooth out that zigzag thing so that the spikes are getting smaller and your minimums get a bit closer to your average. Which is why we do cap mods like these. If we add more capacitors, we can smooth out the voltage even more. Now that has different effects on different graphics cards. That very much depends on what graphics card you have, how useful cap mods are. But yeah, that's why we do cap mods, basically to smooth out the voltage even more. Then, well, the volt mod, you can see one here, that's for the memory. Well, yeah, I've made a video about this already. That's basically just to give us a higher average voltage, which kind of gets around the minimum thing, but you want to do both if you want to the full program. But yeah, that's not really part of what you usually have on a graphics card PCB, so let's go to the next thing. So one more variant of voltage supply we have over here. That is a small chip, and that is a low dropout regulator, or LDO for short. And what this does, it is basically a voltage divider. Now, I hope you paid attention in physics class, because I'm not gonna explain what a voltage divider is. Like, you know, that you put two resistors in series and then you take a measurement in between the two resistors and you get a different voltage like that, a voltage divider. Pretty basic stuff. This is basically just a voltage divider in a chip, and this is used for low current rails because it is fairly inefficient compared to a buck converter, which is why the big power rails where a lot of current, where a lot of power goes through, you have buck converters. But for lower power things, which is usually the 5 volt power supply, because you only get 12 volts from here and you get only 12 volts and 3.3 volts from here. But sometimes you have you have components that need a 5 volt supply, you usually have a low dropout regulator for that, because there is so little power going through that that the inefficiency of a low dropout regulator is not really a big factor. But yeah, these are usually used for 5 volts and sometimes for other things like the BIOS chips, like this BIOS chip right here. Yeah, that should be the BIOS chip. Sometimes they run off 1.8 volts and sometimes they're also used for some minor rails. Like there is a PEX rail, that's probably this chip over here, that is also a... Actually, I don't know if that's a low dropout regulator or a very, very small buck converter in one chip. But yeah, usually you have some minor rails that draw very, very little power, where you have a very, very small miniature VRM for. That's basically what you have on a graphics card PCB. It's not really that complicated. You have your processing things, like you have a GPU, you have a RAM, and then you have the power delivery for it. So let's take a look at this HD7770 over here, because this has another power rail. So on AMD cards, you have a VDDCI power rail, which powers the memory controller. Again, like on NVIDIA, as far as I know, the memory rail just also powers the memory controller. But on AMD cards, you have a separate power rail for that. That is another VRAM. So this HD7770 is a pretty low power card. You can see the GPU is fairly small. So the VRMs are not really that strongly built. You can see we have a small vCore VRM over here. We have a memory VRM over here. And then here is the VDDCI VRM. So yeah, if you're dealing with an AMD card, you're gonna watch out for the third VRM, because that also, like, there's also modding potential there when you want to overclock. And then again, we have things like this minor rail over here. That's not really that important. Again, we have a low dropout regulator over here. That's probably also 5 volts. And yeah. And then Basically now we could get into the different shapes and like ways you can build a PCB. Just one more thing, you can see it very nicely here. This right here is a control chip for your VRM. So your VRM also has a control chip. Again, not really going into the details, but you have a control chip that controls the VRM, also called a PWM controller. So you can see that pretty nicely here. There's a smaller one for the memory rail. And then like this card, that's a control chip for vCore. This right here is for memory. And then, yeah, just it also has a control chip. It's important if you want to do volt mods and just generally for modding, it's important. But this is about just what's on the PCB, not what you really mod with it. So then here we have a custom PCB of a GTX 580. So the GPU and the memory on this are actually the same. But the PCBs look fairly different because this is a reference PCB and the reference PCBs are usually just made to work and not really do anything else. Custom PCBs like this are usually designed with overclocking potential in mind or to make the card more efficient, which is why we have a much bigger VRM right here. And you see one thing here, you can't really differentiate where vCore ends and vMEM starts because you have just one big strip of 10 inductors. So you might think this is a 10 phase, it's not. This is an 8 phase vCore and a 2 phase memory. But they kind of look like a big 10 phase VRM. So this can happen that cards just have one big strip where it looks like both two VRMs are one, but they're actually not. One way you can find out is just you go to the inductor, you take a multimeter and you measure the resistance because the core usually has a very low resistance while the memory usually has around 100 ohms, sometimes 50-ish. The core usually is not higher than 2 ohms. That's how you can find out which part is core, which part is memory. Again, since this is an NVIDIA card, we have no VDDCI VRM on this. But yeah, this is a pretty fairly big VRM with a lot of output capacity filtering and optimization. Like this is a pretty big, powerful PCB compared to the reference one. Another example of a VRM is over here on this GTX 670. Which is using a PCB that's fairly similar to the 680 reference PCB. So here we have again a very similar looking VMEM VRM to the reference card, but the vCore VRM is kind of shrunk down because this GTX 670 is not really that big for power draw, so I don't really need a big VRM, though it would be beneficial for overclocking. So we have a 4-phase VRM right here, and you can see it's kind of weirdly rotated 90 degrees where the output goes this way instead of this way. This is probably, like, this is actually not the best way. You kind of want to do it in this way because the closer your VRM is to the thing you're trying to power, the better the voltage delivery is going to be. And by doing this, you kind of add some extra distance. But the likely reason why they did this is that this card usually was originally came with a blower heatsink. And so they needed to make place for the fan sitting here, which is probably also why the power connectors are stacked and not like next to each other, like on most cards. So the next one is going to be fairly interesting because this finally has MOSFETs in a different package, or more precisely does not have them because I actually removed the VRM, both VRMs on this card, because this has a defect. I tried to fix it and I messed up. Now I can't repair it. Not by repairing the VRM, it needs an e-power to work. So this is a GTX 970, and this uses MOSFETs in different packages. So you can kind of see where the VRM was. It had 4 inductors for the core and then 2 little inductors for the memory again. Here in the back is still the controller for vCore. Here was the controller for the memory VRM. And you can see the imprints here. There's only 4 imprints and also only 2 for the memory. So this is not using discrete MOSFETs. This is using, for the memory VRM, dual NFETs. So that's literally just 2 MOSFETs in one chip. And then for the vCore VRM, it's using DR MOSFETs. Now the DR MOSFETs are also two MOSFETs in one chip, but they include a driver. Now, usually you have an external driver, which are these slightly smaller chips right here, right next to the VRAM. But the DRMOSes integrate that driver. And then there's one step above that that looks similar. That would be a power stage. And a power stage integrates some more things like current monitoring, short circuit protection, temperature monitoring. Like, a power stage is a really, really expensive, really fancy way of having pretty much almost the entire VRM in one chip. You still need inductors and an external controller, but power stages are what you find on some high-end graphics cards these days. So yeah, you do not always have discrete MOSFETs. You can sometimes have them integrated into one chip, like on this GTX 970 here. And also what you can see on this is the VRM is actually on the left side. So it's not always on the right side. It can be on the left side of the GPU where the display I/O is, actually the same where this 7770 has the vCore VRM and the memory the VDDCI VRM on the left side. So that can happen, usually on slightly lower power cards or compact PCBs. Usually the very big powerful PCBs use this configuration where there's a big powerful VRM on the right side. But that kind of changed with the 20 series for NVIDIA and the 30 series for NVIDIA as well. And I have seen a video that supposedly, not a video, I have seen a picture that supposedly shows a leaked photo, like a leaked PCB for a RX 6800 that also does this. Now, on newer cards, I don't have an example here because I don't really feel like tearing down my main system right now, but the graphics card in there does this. So, starting with the 2080 Ti, NVIDIA did something where they took one part of the vCore VRM and put it on the left side. So now you have the vCore VRM split in two, powering the chip from both sides. That still is one big VRM, it's just in different places because usually you put them right next to each other because you want to have them as close to the thing you're trying to power as possible. But you can actually get some slightly better results by halving the VRM and putting it on the other side, because now you're powering the chip from both sides, which means that these two corners of the chip are technically closer to the VRM than before. But the important thing is that still one big VRM. It changes with the RTX 3080 and 3090 because their NVIDIA actually not only had one big VRM on both sides, they actually split the vCore VRM into two different VRMs. So there's not really a naming norm yet. I've seen people call it vCore 1 and vCore 2. I've seen people call it vCore and Uncore. So basically what happened on the RTX 30... Oops, I hit something, sorry. What basically happened on the RTX 3080 and 3090 is the vCore VRM was split into two different VRMs that now power different parts of the GPU. So the vCore or vCore 1 VRM would still power like the cores, the RT cores, tensor cores, I think maybe the cache of the GPU. And then the vCore 2 or Uncore VRM would power everything else in the GPU. So some minor things that I don't really know how they're called. But if you look up the block diagram of pretty much any GPU or die shots even, you see that there is a lot complexity apart from the cores. Like, there's not just processing cores in the GPU, there's a lot more complexity in there. And so basically on the 30 series NVIDIA cards, you have a main vCore VRM, which is just powering the cores and all that, and then a secondary VRM, which is powering the extra complexity that's in the VRM. So I think NVIDIA might continue doing this. I don't know how AMD is going to handle it. Like, again, the only thing I've seen was a supposedly leaked picture that might not even be real. But yeah, so I hope this was somewhat comprehensible. A video is long. Wow, I really thought this was shorter than 25 minutes. Well, Well, anyways, I hope this kind of helped you understand what you have before you when you open up a graphics card PCB. So like you have your GPU, you have your VRAM, and then you have everything that's powering it. There is some extra complexity that I left out here, like basically everything you see here on the left, which is just circuitry for the display connectors, like DVI and HDMI can carry audio. They carry power to maybe power things in the screen, as far as I know. Sometimes you have an USB-C connector. There's of course a small VRM back there, but it's not really that important for what you do when you're overclocking or just generally. Usually every card has the same kind of thing there, so it's not really that important. What's important is the main VRAMs, so for NVIDIA, vCore, vMEM, and for AMD, also VDDCI. And yeah, so the video is already pretty long. I hope this helped you a bit. So thank you all for watching, hope you enjoyed, and until we see each other next time, goodbye.